I didn't see you come in. Welcome to part three of my review of Alongside Night. Hold on, I'm almost done with this. Hold on. Just a little bit longer.
When we last left our hero, Elliot, with his new handler friend, Larnell, they were going to the underground ANCAP mall. And what we get is about 9 minutes of libertarian circle jerk. In fact, Neil J. Showman has uploaded this very clip on YouTube titled, "The Most Libertarian Movie Sequence Ever." However, that's not what we get. What we get is pretty much a glorification of a lot of libertarian strawmen and plugs for stateless suites and Liberty Coin Service.
Cut! Hey, don't look at the camera!
Oh, wait. Neil's directing this. Never mind. Keep rolling. Oh, and Austin Peterson. Another booth they have inside this mall is the Mex I Can Immigrant Protection Insurance. And of course, they're using an Italian flag, not a Mexican flag. I love Mexico. Never mind. The next booth we're encountered with is the G. Gerald Romas Border Guard and Ketchup Company. I wonder what he sells.
No, a gentleman deals in neither frontier guards nor ketchup. I am a cannabist.
Oh. Okay. Well, by the way, this ain't no pot store I've ever been to. And I used to live in California, and I used to go to these medical dispensaries. They look nothing like that, and thank God. So they stray from the booth a little bit and go into one of the mall stores, which is a brothel, I think, and a church, I think, headed by Dennis Hoff, who's sitting there with his prostitute girls. I think I know why Neil lives in Pahrump now. Now, next he's giving a lecture about pro-life, pro-sex Christianity while the lady nonchalantly holds a Bible. I said nonchalantly. And then there's that gang sign again. And look, I know I am not in the back of the theater on this one. Something is definitely not being explained here. Then they cut to Anarcho Bank, the first anarchist bank, where Elliot trades in a gold coin to a teller with a keyboard tie for paper money, and then he's offered a bank account. And don't worry, I know you love seeing a bank teller sitting there and counting money for a few minutes, so they indulge. Get on with it. Next, they go into a drugstore. Those kind of drugs, where he gets a lesson about how drugs will be handled in a free society. Elliot asks what's to stop him from buying all the chemist's drugs and selling them to 11-year-olds. The chemist tells him that he would refuse to sell it to anyone who would even joke about such a thing, and if someone actually did that, he would make it public that this deranged person should never be allowed to buy drugs again from any other store, preventing him from doing it again. I'm just kidding.
So, if you buy our drugs, please don't do that.
I'm sure all the statists are convinced by that one. And anyways, they go into a discussion about personal responsibility and... Wait. Oh! He's not an anarchist yet. Yeah, that was explained well. I guess he didn't like Miss Danforth because she was an ANCAP and he wasn't yet. Not the other way around. Why are drugs in a free society have more explanation than the actual fucking plot of this movie, Neil? Then they take a trip into the gun... Legume? Oh, that's not a nut, Neil. Where we get one of the best scenes in the entire movie. I can't even intro this. It's just that awesome. Just watch.
Well, class, that about wraps up our First Amendment, and I'm going to leave the second to Miss Applebottom.
That is Miss Applewater. Okay, the Second Amendment is... A well-regulated militia, being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms, shall not be infringed.
Now, this right is an incredible amendment to have, because our right to bear arms is all that stands between us and complete social chaos.
I mean, the CGI in this looks so bad, you could have used Second Life and improved it tenfold.
his hat behind our bedroom door.
Man, after this place, I believe you if you told me someone here sells nukes.
Sells what?
Sells nukes.
Sells what?
Sells nukes.
What?
Sells nukes.
Snooze? Why wouldn't they sell snooze? Then we get a lesson how nuclear arms would be sold in Ancapistan.
Roughly the same blast as Hiroshima and Nagasaki, but with a far smaller yield than a hydrogen fusion device.
Man, Christopher Walken really let himself go. Basically, if you have money, you can have people help you create nukes. But don't worry, there's a background check. Now, how nukes would be handled in a free society is a very complicated topic that no one really has a perfect answer for because of the nature of nuclear arms. They're very non-discriminating and tactically useless for defense. There's lots of great discussion about this, and it's very in-depth and complex for a one-minute explanation, and it's probably not a good idea to have it in such something so introductionary into libertarian media. But even still, if you could do it, this is a very poor explanation for it. Oh yeah, malls will just sell nuclear arms right next to the heroin store. There's a 15-day waiting period constructed by the very people the mass media deems to be terrorists. Seems legit. I'm sorry, but this sounds more like a straw man of libertarianism than actual libertarian, doesn't it? I mean, just like the video of Konkin, real Konkin. Does anybody really believe that in Ancapistan there's just going to be videos of random libertarians giving talks? God, I hope not.
This is a G-rate alert. We are commencing evacuation immediately. Remain calm. We have a firm 2 hours until the G-rate.
Oh, God. The government finally does something good for once and ends this nightmare of a fucking scene. Granted, they do it with extra normal, but, they're the government. By the way, that's a wonderful insurance title card.
Shut up and take my money!
So anyways, they leave and part ways, only to find Goldman, who tells them that their family is okay, his father is free and hanging out in his apartment, but his mom and sister are locked up in Utopia, the FEMA camp, so we're getting a little bit of explanation. They meet back up and take the elevator, and it turns out they were under the school the entire time. And Konkin tells him, oh yeah, this is common for the revolutionary agorist cadre to create underground malls and hotels all the time. It's no big deal. We had one in New York for a while. They go back to his buddy's house where the dog is still tearing up the place. Oh yeah. Anyways, it's cold inside and they find his friend's uncle had committed suicide. Laurel says that her mother had committed suicide just last week. Why is there a close-up of his ring? Does the ring mean something? I really wish this movie would explain stuff. They go back to the apartment where his dad is and catch up on some things and... then the FEMA camp people show up, and then they have a Mexican standoff. No! Mexican! She reveals that she's the FEMA camp director's daughter, and then they decide to send Elliot with Loreno to Utopia to find out who kidnapped the family, and once they find out who kidnaps the family, they're going to side with the other team, because, tribes. They leave, and Neil's downstairs doing the gang sign as if he didn't stand out like a sore thumb already. They get in his car and, oh, look, there's the evil teacher who got the government job on their tail. But Fake and Jamaican is there on backup and thwarts them with some sort of bright light thing. What the hell is that?
Magnesium.
Oh, thanks. Wait, why would you explain that but nothing else? Night scene. They show up at the new cadre location and, yep, there's another different gang sign. They meet up with these guys and learn what Utopia is, and that they have the plans to blow up the Death Star. Elliot and Lorraine agree to help. Then they do the Pledge of Allegiance. What the fuck, anarchists? Then they learn about the Al Gore something rather.
Then the Al Gore Global Atmospheric Carbon Reduction Facility in Henderson.
Yeah, that. Then they're going to break in, stun the guards, broadcast the FEMA camp on TV so that people can see what they've been doing and get upset and start another revolution. Because they didn't already notice this FEMA camp. They get there and shit green screen, different color temperatures, and unnecessary long driving scenes their way into the facility. What is that? So anyways, they keep getting inside and... Keep getting inside.
Done with it.
Yes, get over there. Yeah!
So they get in and have a nice little reunion and find out Elliot's family has been, quote unquote, taken out. I don't know if that means they're dead or just removed. I don't know. They get inside their holding cell and Chin knocks this dude out. And then there's a screen of just kind of flashing between other people's rooms of them sleeping and whatever, because tyranny. And then the SWAT team moves in and then we get some unnecessarily long clips of them messing with electronics, because this is interesting. Okay. I get it. I understand. I know you're doing stuff. Okay. By the way, this is the most boring revolution I've ever seen. All right, come on. Fuck. Anyways, then this happens, which perplexes me to no end.
I have several questions.
Okay, so I'm not alone here. Anyways, a FEMA dude gets on the camera and threatens to self-destruct the facility unless he tells him where they are. Elliot tries to bribe him and fails, and he starts the countdown sequence anyways. Now, let me ask you a question. What do you think is going to happen next? Does he, A, give a villainous pun and takes out the facility and sneaks out the back door? B, yell Allah Akbar and take himself out with everyone else? C, have a change of heart and assist Elliot in disarming the bomb? Or D, get really emotional and ask Elliot to do him a favor by rescuing a baby he slides out of a miniature door only because the baby looks a little bit like his own kid who isn't even there and allow himself to die? If you answer D, you are both idiotic and correct.
Blood of patriots and tyrants.
Anyways, they get the baby and escape in time, and they manage to get a video of his buddy right before he dies in the whatever that is. And it shows him putting on a ring and spinning it on his finger, and he says,
"This is it, man. I hope you know what this means."
Oh my god, that's the fucking gang sign, is them spinning a fucking golden ring that you could barely tell what they're doing? That's the gang sign? That's the anarchist gang sign? Oh no, I still don't know what this means! What does this mean? So after that, these quote-unquote terrorists who are wanted for the high crimes against the government hold the press conference publicly. Now that the government's gone, because apparently all the government's gone because they were inside Utopia? No, that can't be right. Or something not explained why everyone isn't being arrested right now. Anyways, they explained it. Gee, this guy doesn't look suspicious at all. Hi, FEMA camp guy in the obvious disguise. Anyways, Dr. Velen comes around to anarchy because these guys aren't bad after all or something. And fake beard guy tries to assassinate Velen, but is shot by Elliot, then yay, we're having fun now because my dad's dead. And then Konkin, who is at home watching himself on cable TV, explaining how private defense agencies work now that they're in a free society, starts mumbling something about the Bill of Rights for a really long time again. And then he puts a period after Congress shall make no law. You see? Because Congress shouldn't make any laws because, you know, because anarchy. Right? Because that's what we want. See, it's kind of like taking their thing and then, like, using it against them. It's kind of like, you know, it's kind of clever. You see what? Because there's a period after Congress shall make no law, and they just put it there instead of just doing the whole thing. And that's why that's funny, because it's... And then Adam Kokesh talks and Jordan Page plays some music. And then there's a long list of credits where virtually every other libertarian in the entire world is thanked. And then that's it. No more Jamaican guy. No, I'm not going to allow this. So I have something to admit. Originally, when I started this movie, I thought it was so bad. But as I continue watching it, there's a soft spot in my heart for this movie. Not a soft spot in this movie that you would consider for any other film, like a good film, but more along the lines of The Room or Birdemic. Now, originally I said that it was not like Birdemic or The Room because those were so bad that it's good. But now I've sort of kind of taken a liking to this movie because it's so bad. It's great. And then there's also another lie. I said that this video was going to be in three parts. And it technically is. However, I'm going to do a follow-up video in it talking about some of the responses that I received because of this thing, mostly from Neil J. Shulman, which is interesting, to say the least. So until next time, worms.